There are spies everywhere, watching from the shadows, hiding in the crowds. They live in a world cloaked in secrecy and laced with danger. A world that we know best from the movies. Whether it's James Bond in an explosive shootout, or one of Jason Bourne's pulsating getaways. Spy movies make for spectacular viewing.
Oh God, let's do this!
But what's the truth behind all this mayhem? The gunfights, the chases, and the hair-raising stunts.
So badass!
This is great!
Tonight we'll find out with the help of the experts. Real-life spies and secret agents. They'll be giving us the lowdown on their big-screen counterparts.
I think he's probably the world's worst spy, because everywhere he goes, he's expected.
And spilling the beans on their tricks of the trade.
Fast cars, women, weapons, danger. That's a Hollywood cliché.
He said, have you ever thought of working for your country?
In a TV first, our spooks will be counting down their favorite spy movies from 10 to 1. So slip on your secret agent glasses, put away your exploding pen, and stand by to be thrilled by the world's greatest spy movies. At number 10, our spies chose Mission Impossible. Here's Tom Cruise in a scene from the original and still the best of these overblown blockbusters. But it's not all bang, crash, and wallop. Shh. Here he comes again. In the movie's most iconic scene, Cruise breaks into a maximum security vault to steal secret intelligence from a CIA computer. It might all seem a wee bit far-fetched, but real-life CIA officer Jonna Mendez isn't so sure.
We could accomplish this, let's say that. And there was a group who was responsible for doing this sort of thing. And when you went to visit the chief of that group, on the wall behind his desk were all the pieces of equipment you would need to scale a mountain. That was his gear that he used in a really, really, within our office, famous operation.
Here's another iconic sequence that our real spies picked out as surprisingly true to life. Tom Cruise loves a disguise. And so does Jonna Mendez. She was head of disguise at the CIA.
I enjoyed using disguise and seeing how you can just disappear. And it's wonderfully useful, a good disguise. It'll save your life.
But what about the lifelike mask that Cruise is pulling on here? Bob Baer is an ex-CIA agent who's worked undercover in some of the world's most volatile places.
That's called a semi-automated mask. It's latex, goes over your face, and we use those all the time. They're great. Your nose, your face moves with them because the muscles will actually move the mask. They're thin enough. They're just plastic. They fold up. You can put them in a bag. You can go in the bathroom. You can do the dent transfer anywhere. You can walk in the bathroom, come out as somebody else.
The CIA may have the same kit as Cruise, but there's one thing real spies don't find as easy as Tom does. Acting.
When you first wear a disguise, I have to tell you, you get paranoid, you get worried, and it's not the disguise that will give you away, it's your behavior. You just kind of feel furtive. You're inclined to speed up. So to slow myself down, I put gravel in the toes of my shoes, and it was painful. My toes were bleeding, but I walked nice and slow. Wearing a mask is is a heady thing.
Next up, at number 9 in our spy movie countdown, our experts picked out a film which proves that in the world of espionage, real life is sometimes stranger than fiction. Argo is a triple Oscar-winning film about an incredible, true story. Ben Affleck plays a CIA officer who volunteers to go undercover to rescue 6 American diplomats trapped in Iran. It was 1980, the height of an Islamic revolution. Iran was one of the world's most dangerous places for an American spy. So in a clever twist, Affleck sets off for Hollywood to build an elaborate cover story that the 6 Americans in Iran aren't diplomats, but a film crew. In this scene, Affleck tries to persuade a world-weary film producer to help him pretend to be making a movie in Iran.
Hi, I only got a couple of minutes. I'm getting a Lifetime Achievement Award.
Mazel tov, Lester.
I'd rather stay home and count the wrinkles on my dog's balls. Okay, you got 6 people hiding out in the town of what? 4 million people, all of whom chant death to America all the livelong day. You want to set up a movie in a week. You want to lie to Hollywood, a town where everybody lies for a living. Then you're going to sneak 007 over here into a country that wants CIA blood on their breakfast cereal. And you're going to walk the Brady Bunch out of the most watched city in the world.
Asked about 100 militia at the airport. That's right.
Right. Look, I gotta tell you, we did suicide missions in the army that had better odds than this.
The real-life spy played by Affleck is the CIA's Tony Mendez. We asked him about Argo.
It's a good story. Tells well.
Now 75 and suffering from Parkinson's, Tony's asked his wife and fellow ex-spook Jonna to help him tell us about the Hollywood cover story.
Didn't you tell The Office you thought it might actually be fun?
Well, exactly. We always like to have fun in our important jobs, which meant we were winning.
Tony went to extraordinary lengths to make his cover story credible. He designed posters for his fake movie. He set up a fully staffed production office called Studio 6 and ensured it made a splash in the trade press. The film company front was so convincing that even Spielberg sent a script in. Once inside revolutionary Iran, Affleck makes contact with the 6 diplomats. And the tension starts to rack up. In this critical scene, he's coaching the diplomats on their cover stories.
Good. What's your job on the movie?
Producer.
Associate producer. What was the last movie you produced?
High and Dry.
Who paid for that?
CFDC.
What's your middle name? What's your middle name? What's your middle name?
Leon?
Shoot him. He's an American spy. Look, they're going to try to break you, okay? By trying to get you agitated. You have to know your resume back to front.
You really believe your little story is going to make a difference when there's a gun to our heads?
I think my story is the only thing between you and a gun to your head.
It's gripping stuff. But what was it like in real life? Lee Schatz was one of the 6 Tony was trying to smuggle out.
Everybody kind of took it as an assignment. You know, okay, I can learn this. Most important part for me is that it was clear this wasn't a plan he was handing us for us to execute. He was going to do it with us.
One of the film's most vivid scenes is at border control at Tehran Airport, where the cover story is put to the test.
If they have a question, you know, you pull down the mustache, you do whatever you need to, and remain cool. And I just made eye contact.
At the last minute, the Iranians realize they've been fooled. Cue a nail-biting chase down the runway. In reality, it wasn't quite this touch and go. Lee and the rest breezed through the airport, largely thanks to Tony Mendez and his inspirational plan.
Can I say something that you told me? Because I never figured it out before. When they assembled that cover story out in LA, when they took out ads, when they became realer than real, they had signs up, they were an honest-to-goodness production company. The consumer of that cover was not really meant to be the Iranians. It was for the Six.
Yes.
It was to give them the backbone to walk into that airport.
Have a little courage.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is our pleasure to announce that alcoholic beverages are now available as we have cleared Iranian airspace.
Actually, it was accurate. Airspace was really the where it was over for us. We all ordered Bloody Marys.
Oh yeah, Bloody Marys all around.
Once back in the US, the six Americans were greeted as returning heroes and photographed with the president. But Tony, who put his life on the line to rescue them, was not in the picture. His role was kept secret for almost 20 years. The CIA finally came clean about it in 1997, and Tony emerged from the shadows to become one of the most celebrated spies in America.
Tony, I think, knew that the people this meant the most to had the utmost admiration for him. He's a friend.
Coming up, the spy spoof that's proved to be a surprise hit with our real-life secret agents.
This is great, right?
Frankly, that's my idea of real intelligence.
We're counting down the top 10 spy movies with the help of real secret agents. At number 8, it's a Hollywood comedy that offers some unexpected insights.
I guess that CIA training isn't what it used to be.
Kiss your right ass up.
This ballsy spoof starring Melissa McCarthy may seem a surprising choice, but according to our experts, the belly laughs conceal an astute understanding of how the spy world really works.
Oh, God. Oh, Susan, what did you do?
Oh, God, not on him! Not on him!
McCarthy is on sparkling form as Susan Cooper, a quiet CIA analyst who can only dream of becoming an agent.
Mon conseil à vous.
Un vin blanc sec, Thomas Chardonnay.
Mais quelle année?
Can you imagine me as a spy?
Oh, my God. Out in the field.
Yeah.
With a gun.
What?
Susan is in awe of Jude Law, who looks every inch the super spy.
I'm gonna shoot you, not me.
Look at you and your tailor and your... Everything is cut right and mine's... It's like a lumpy pumpkin sack dress. It doesn't even have a label. It does not have a label, and I think my mom made it. And
no,
I probably just get down on my hands and knees and start scooting.
Go easy on yourself.
Okay.
But Melissa Maley, a former CIA operative, isn't nearly as impressed by Jude Law as Susan is.
You know, this is one of those scenes that is so typical. You've got the suave, debonair man who's the spy, and you've got the woman playing the support role, and she's this pathetic woman and this guy saying, oh, don't cry. This is not espionage. This is movies.
Maley herself rose to become one of the top undercover agents in the Middle East.
When I joined the CIA, it was during the Cold War. I definitely just was the odd person out. And I had been hired because I had spent a lot of time in the Middle East, I had spoke Arabic, and I had this, you know, body of knowledge that would make me a good operative.
You are top of your class at the Academy.
In one of Spy's sharpest scenes, Susan Cooper's hidden talents are revealed when she's shown a video recording of her combat training.
So imagine my surprise when I saw footage from this drill back at the farm.
Sarah, I can't even. Is that me? I can't really.
Stupid gun!
Yeah. Sorry, you definitely sped this up.
Valerie Plame was another of the CIA's top covert operatives.
This is great, right? A classic case of what she looks like versus what she's capable of doing.
Okay, ouch. Out of context, that's, you know.
I must have watched this 15 times now, because what the fuck?
Well, I
almost put it up on YouTube.
But her boss then gives her a mission, but with a cover story that doesn't quite float her boat.
We'll be giving you a new identity. You'll no longer be Susan Cooper.
Oh,
your new
name.
I had
a few ideas for that. I was just spitballing, and I thought Serafina, Maddox, Giselle, and
Carol Jenkins.
This clip made me laugh because in the CIA, you do get pseudonyms, and they're randomly generated. So you hope and you pray the pseudonym that you get is not something completely stupid.
Huh?
Carol Jenkins is a single mother of four, temporarily relocated from Delaware to increase sales for a software company.
Okay, that is a different occup...
Their problem?
No. I was just wondering if this is my family or if I've taken hostages.
She's going to be a frumpy mom on a mission. That's not, you know, her idea of cool, but frankly, that's my idea of real intelligence.
Don't be fooled by the ludicrous pink shell suit. The film shows how women make great spies.
Great, that's a real confidence builder.
Women are less threatening and better listeners. All of which is very, very helpful when you are in this very delicate back and forth dance of recruiting someone. You'd be surprised how many people in the world don't feel that anyone pays them any attention. And you are maybe the first person in a long time to come along and go, really? Can you tell me more about that?
If you look at me, do I look threatening? Would you be afraid to go out and have lunch with me? Probably not. I look very nice. I look very friendly. Of course you want to have lunch with me.
Susan Cooper may not always be the most subtle of operatives.
Oh, God. Let's do this.
But our real spooks found much to admire in her.
Usually, I'm pretty critical about espionage movies because in the industry, they get it wrong. I liked the movie because it told the story of, you know, spies come in all different shapes and forms. They are very sharp. They have a good sense of humor. Plus, it was just incredibly funny.
Next up, it's back to the 60s. And a classic British film that gave the world a new kind of secret agent. In the Ypres file, Michael Caine gives a note-perfect performance as Harry Palmer. An East End lad with a taste for the finer things. He even grinds his own beans.
During the period of this movie, coffee sales of real ground coffee quadrupled in England.
In a striking contrast to the glamour of your average spy movie, the Ypres file even sets a spy meet in a supermarket.
This scene is fantastic. It's a very witty way of counterpointing the Bond, the fact that he does his shopping. You know, you think Bond wouldn't be seen dead in a supermarket.
He may not be posh, but when Palmer bumps into his boss by the tinned veg...
Oh, good morning, sir.
he shows he's nobody's fool.
Champignon. You're paying 10 pence more for a fancy French label. If you want button mushrooms, you'll get better value on the next show.
It's not just the label. These do have a better flavor.
Of course. You're quite a gourmet, aren't you, Palmer?
The plot concerns the kidnapping and brainwashing of government scientists. When Palmer discovers the truth, he's forced to endure a terrifying experiment in mind control.
I want to fit the rhythm of the sound and vision to the pattern of his brainwaves. I think it'll make for a much deeper response.
It all feels very far out, but this brainwashing scene reflects a dark episode from real-life 60s espionage.
Quite relaxed.
Fifty years ago, Don Webb was tricked into becoming a guinea pig for an intelligence service experiment in mind alteration. As a young serviceman, he volunteered to take part in a test at Porton Down, a government laboratory. Don was told they were just looking for a cure for the common cold.
We were photographed naked, which was extraordinary. If you could imagine being told to strip off by a young woman photographer and stand on a revolving pedestal, which she then moved round to take various shots of you, stark naked. At the age of 18, it was extraordinary.
The brainwashing scene in Ypres is tripped out psychedelia. And for Don, that's how it actually was.
We were handed glasses of clear liquid to drink and then sent away back to our billets to be on our own.
Don had been given LSD. The spooks weren't interested in curing colds, but looking for a truth drug to make people talk in interrogations.
And all of a sudden, on every surface that I can see, there would be like 2 to 3 inches of clear, viscous liquid, which was moving and writhing over all the surfaces, the flat surfaces, the walls, the things. And then the surfaces started to melt. That was horrible. Then we were just put back on lorries and sent away.
Don Webb was lied to by his own side. At the end of Ypres, Harry Palmer realizes he was tricked by his bosses into putting his sanity on the line. Kane's performance captures the disillusionment of an agent hung out to dry by his own side.
You used me as a decoy. I might have been killed or driven stark raving mad.
That's what you paid for.
Coming up, the most famous secret agent in cinema. We find out what the real spies think of James Bond.
The head of MI6 once referred to James Bond as the greatest recruiting sergeant the service has ever had.
I think he's probably the world's worst spy, because everywhere he goes, he's expected.
We're counting down the world's greatest spy movies. And it's cinema's most famous secret agent at number 6. 007 first appeared on the big screen in Dr. No in 1962, in a scene which has passed into cinematic history.
I admire your courage, Miss...
Trench. Sylvia Trench. I admire your luck, Mr...
Bond. James Bond.
50 years and 26 movies later, Bond is still the daddy of all the big screen secret agents. In a moment, we'll find out what our real life spies think is the best Bond film of all time. But first, since the beginning, James Bond has been making spying sexy. And let's be honest, sometimes, more than a little cheesy.
Bond, what do you think you're doing?
Keeping the British end up, sir.
But what do our real spies make of 007? Harry Ferguson joined MI6 in the 1980s, about the time when Roger Moore was handing over to Timothy Dalton.
I come from the classic Le Carré-type background. In my final year at Oxford, tutor simply said to me, "What do you think you're doing when you go down, Harry?" And I didn't really have much idea, so I was thinking maybe the army or the police or something. He said, "Have you ever thought of working for your country?" You know, I had no idea what he was talking about. So obviously, you knew there was James Bond, but at the same time, you knew James Bond was probably nothing like the actual work.
So, how true to life are those essential Bond accessories, the gadgets?
Strap it on your wrist.
Here's one of the most ingenious gadget scenes from Moonraker.
It's activated by nerve impulses from the wrist muscles.
Like this? Oh, thank you.
Another explosive, memorable moment from The Living Daylights.
Something we're making for the Americans. It's called a Ghetto Blaster.
And many people's favorite, this thoroughly silly little number from Octopussy. This may seem far-fetched, but real spies do use gadgets.
I once had to record an interview with an informant. I wasn't going to be able to make notes. I was going to get one shot at it, and it was going to be incredibly technical. There was going to be a lot of chemical formulas in it. I couldn't carry in a recording device, so a lot of time was spent building one into a jacket. Tested it twice in the 10 minutes before I had to use it. It worked perfectly. Sat through a 20-minute interview, taking all this very detailed technical knowledge, it didn't work. Unlike the Bond films and similar films, spies hate gadgets. Gadgets can be found and gadgets will let you down.
Perhaps that's why in the most recent Bond movies, gadgets have fallen out of fashion and 007 doesn't seem too happy about it.
A gun and a radio. Not exactly Christmas, is it?
Were you expecting an exploding pen? We don't really go in for that anymore.
Even more memorable than the gadgets are Bond's cars. And it was in Goldfinger that Bond's favourite made its spectacular debut. The iconic Aston Martin DB5. But a real-life spy wouldn't be seen dead in an Aston Martin.
The thing about the vehicles that spies drive is that they have to fit the environment, so you're much more likely to find yourself in a Seat Leon than you are in a Lamborghini. It's all about fitting into the background. And while every service has its technical departments, which can build you a DB5 with machine guns, you don't really want that. You might occasionally need a car that looks rather beat up, where they've souped up the engine because you might need to get out quick. They might need one where you're expecting trouble and you need some bulletproofing built into the doors and things. But more often than not, you'll find yourself driving some pretty shabby cars when you're a spy because that's what works in real life.
There's one aspect of Daniel Craig's Bond that all our real-life spies recognised. Being a secret agent screws you up.
I'd like to start with some simple word association. Just tell me the first word that pops into your head. For example, I might say day, and you might say
wasted.
And this pointed scene from Skyfall gives a genuine insight into how spying messes with your mind.
Gun.
Shot.
Agent.
Provocateur.
Woman.
Provocatrix.
Heart.
Target.
If you are a secret agent, you see your government at its worst, because the reason that every country has secret services is to do things they don't want to be known about. And that can make you awfully cynical.
Bird.
Sky.
M.
Bitch.
It's a very strange environment to work in, because once you become part of that world, you have to cut off your normal life. I mean, it certainly had an impact in the sense of glass pane developing between you and the real world. Because you can't talk about anything to your old friends, even your family. And they find it equally frustrating.
Thank you.
So perhaps we should forgive Bond his personality flaws.
I'm the money.
But in Casino Royale, he He gets more than he bargains for when he turns on the charm.
All right. By the cut of your suit, you went to Oxford or wherever. Naturally think human beings dress like that. But you wear it with such disdain. My guess is you didn't come from money. And your school friends never let you forget it. Which means you were at that school by the grace of someone else's charity, hence the chip on your shoulder. And since your first thought about me ran to orphan, that's what I'd say you are.
Oh, there are some quite weird ones, yes, but I'm not sure if it's because they were orphans or anything.
Since MI6 looks for maladjusted young men, I give little thought to sacrificing others in order to protect Queen and country. You know, former SAS types with easy smiles and expensive watches.
This clip actually resonates quite strongly with me because in MI6, you are expected to be a bit of a lone wolf, go out there, be self-sustaining, resilient, and be able to pressure and turn people to report back to you on important matters from their own countries, effectively make them betray their countries.
Now, having just met you, I wouldn't go as far as calling you a cold-hearted bastard.
Yeah, of course not.
But it wouldn't be a stretch to imagine. You think of women as disposable pleasures rather than meaningful pursuits. So as charming as you are, Mr. Bond, I will be keeping my eye on our government's money and off your perfectly formed hours.
You noticed.
In many ways, this conversation's quite dated because you don't want to be able to point at, you know, an old white guy like me and say that's the spy in the room. And as for the perfectly formed arse for MI6 officers, I think I'm letting the side down.
So Bond claims the number 6 spot in our countdown. And what's the best Bond movie, according to our real spies? It's Skyfall. The movie is crammed full of death-defying stunts.
007, are you all right?
Just changing carriages.
It delivers a new and more complex Bond. A man haunted by his past. But best of all, is an explosive sequence at the headquarters of MI6, a building spies love to hate.
It's hideous. I don't know who designed it, but who picks green and beige as the colours of a secret organisation? The best thing that ever happened in a Bond film was when they blew it up.
We're halfway through our spy movie countdown. Coming up, a film about the British agents who helped win the Second World War, but whose vital work was kept top secret for 30 years.
When Churchill came, he stood on a soapbox and to look at you, you are the geese that laid the golden eggs but never cackled.
We're halfway through our countdown of the world's greatest spy movies, chosen by real spies. Next up, the true story of how Allied agents helped win World War II by unlocking a vital military secret.
Why do you wish to work for His Majesty's government?
Oh, I don't really.
Are you a bleeding pacifist?
I'm agnostic about violence.
But you do realize that 60...
In the Oscar-winning Imitation Game, Benedict Cumberbatch gives a vivid portrayal of Alan Turing, the brilliant mathematician who became a codebreaker.
I don't speak German.
Well, how the hell were you supposed to decrypt German communications if you don't... Well, I don't know. Speak German.
Well, I'm really quite excellent at crossword puzzles.
The puzzle that Turing wants to solve is the German wartime code machine, Enigma.
Everyone thinks Enigma is unbreakable.
Good. Let me try, and we'll know for sure, won't we?
The film shows the operation being set up in a perfect period setting, just as it was in reality. The government's code-breaking station at Bletchley Park was a huge enterprise.
It wasn't good enough to have a handful of OK people. You needed the best brains in Britain. And what is miraculous about Bletchley Park, they got them.
Baroness Trumpington was at Bletchley at the same time as Alan Turing.
It was a funny old mixture of people from the very, very, terrific mathematicians like Turing. I think everybody there was necessary in a way.
To crack the Enigma code, an inspired Alan Turing designs a vast electromechanical device.
You nervous?
A forerunner of the modern computer. The film places Turing at the center of this extraordinary story, but the reality was rather more complex.
In the movie, they've got everything being done by Turing, with the guys around him all as spectators. Well, actually, it wasn't like that. It was a fellowship.
Having built his machine, Turing needs a final clue to solve the puzzle.
All other settings. What if he only has to search through ones that produce words we already know will be in the message?
Repeated words. Predictable words.
Exactly.
Look, look, like this one. 0600 hours, weather today is clear, rain in the evening, Heil Hitler.
Oh, that's it.
In a brilliant twist, Turing realizes that to break the code, he only needs to know three words of German.
So that's three words we know will be in every 6 a.m. message. Weather, obviously, and
Heil bloody Hitler.
Heil bloody Hitler.
But breaking the code isn't the end of the problem for Turing. He knows that if the Germans suspect Enigma has been cracked, they will change it. So the film shows him proposing a desperate solution.
We need your help to keep this a secret from Admiralty, Army, RAF. No one can know we broke Enigma.
The decision to keep it secret from the RAF Army or Navy might well have been made, but it would not have been made by the code breakers, by Turing and the fellow mathematicians and people in that circle. It would have been made at a much higher level within the organisation. And certainly my understanding is towards the end of the war, most of the German generals did know that Enigma had been broken, but they were unable to stop using it because they had spent so many years persuading Hitler that it was unbreakable that none of them felt able to tell him that it had now been broken.
Cracking Enigma changed the course of the Second World War, and Prime Minister Winston Churchill made a point of visiting Bletchley to show his appreciation.
When Churchill came, he stood on a soapbox and to look at you, you know, one would not think you knew all those things you do, and you are the geese that laid the golden eggs but never cackled.
Bletchley Park's legacy lives on in the form of the government communications headquarters in Cheltenham. GCHQ is a top secret establishment, but Max Hastings was recently given special access, beginning with a visit to one of the most exclusive museums in Britain.
They've got a Bletchley Museum on the ground floor, and every new recruit to GCHQ is taught through the museum, and they're all told you are the lineal descendants of the people who worked at Bletchley Park. When you stand in the operations room of GCHQ today, you see this vast, sort of like a James Bond set, with these hundreds of screens being monitored around the clock. The most amazing part is the basement, where there's literally the 5 acres of computers, and you just walk down these serried ranks of cases of computers. And if you think about it, this is 5 acres of what Alan Turing started.
Next up in our countdown, we go behind the Iron Curtain to look at the dark side of surveillance in an Oscar-winning film about secrets and betrayal. The Lives of Others is a taut psychological drama set in communist East Germany, where the Secret Service, the Stasi, held the population in an iron grip through the power of mass surveillance. Captain Wiesler of the Stasi is ordered to monitor a suspected dissident. It's a scenario that is very familiar to Bernd Rote. He served in the Stasi for 16 years, rising to the rank of major.
When I worked for the Stasi, I felt like I was at war. That was our mindset back then. Anyone disloyal was simply an enemy.
The subject of the surveillance is a writer, George Drayman. His girlfriend, Christa, is an actress. The film shows the relish with which the Stasi agents listen in on the most intimate aspects of their lives.
Oh, die sind ja schon bei der Sache. Das gibt's ja gar nicht. Diese Künstler. Bei denen geht's ab. Wissen Sie, Kollege, deswegen überwache ich lieber Künstler als Priester und diese Friedensapostel.
Nein.
No. No. The way we conducted operations meant that the Stasi couldn't be voyeuristic. For example, if someone was listening in on lovemaking, he would just note down lovemaking. He wouldn't comment on how much the couple enjoyed it. That wasn't the point. The point was to find out if something was said between him and her that could be used in an interrogation.
Thomas Onnesight knows all about the Stasi's attitude to dissent. In the 1980s, he was one of a gang of East German punks looking for a way to liven up their surroundings.
We used spray cans to cover the town of Weimar with graffiti. Turn the state into cucumber salad. Things like that. But for the Stasi, this was no laughing matter. A red line had been crossed. And they pursued us as enemies of the state.
Thomas and his friends were rounded up and imprisoned. But the Stasi hadn't needed bugging to identify them. They had an informant.
We didn't find out until 20 years later that the informer was my brother. That, of course, was the biggest shock for us, and for me especially.
Thomas's brother was one of thousands of collaborators recruited by the Stasi who betrayed their friends and family. And betrayal is at the heart of the tragedy in the lives of others. The Stasi suspect George Drayman of writing an anonymous article criticizing the regime. But to prove it, they need to find his typewriter. So they arrest Drayman's girlfriend.
Drayman muss sowieso ins Gefängnis.
And in this emotionally charged scene, we see exactly how the Stasi pressurized people into betrayal.
Retten Sie jetzt wenigstens sich selber. Sie würden nicht glauben, wie viele Menschen hier wegen sinnlosem Heroismus im Gefängnis sitzen. Sagen Sie mir, wo die Maschine versteckt ist. Drayman wird nie etwas erfahren. Ich lasse sie sofort frei.
Der Zweck heiligt die Mittel.
The end justified the means. And the means we used to get results was to lead people into betrayal. Of course.
Sagen Sie mir, wo die Unterlagen sind. Wo sind Sie?
Sie sind in der Wohnung. Unter der Türschwelle. Zwischen Wohnzimmer und Flur. Man kann sie abnehmen.
Krista's betrayal is the pivotal moment in the film, which leads to the inevitable search of Draymond's apartment.
Na, was haben wir denn da? Diese Schwelle scheint mir nicht ganz koscher. Könnte es ein Geheimfach sein?
The film's climactic scene shows the tragic consequences when betrayal becomes an instrument of state security.
Lassen Sie, sie steht hier nicht unter Verdacht.
You can't judge every betrayal the same way. Where somebody's put under pressure, you've got to be more understanding. None of us know what we would do in a situation like that.
We're close to discovering the world's greatest spy movie, as chosen by the spooks themselves. Coming next, everyone's favorite rogue agent, and our experts reveal what it's like to be on the run.
You do feel that you can't trust anyone. Any corner you turn, any car that drives past, it won't be long before a mistake happens.
We're counting down the world's greatest spy movies. We've had a masterclass in creating the perfect cover story and found out what real spies make of James Bond. Now we're into our top three movies. At number three is a trilogy of films that's made almost $1 billion at the box office and features a spy who is the most troublesome rogue agent on the big screen. Matt Damon is Jason Bourne, a spy who's been turned into a lethal weapon. He's a top CIA assassin.
The Jason Bourne stuff, I like it, but these films are made up by people in sitting in Malibu looking at the beach. There are no spies that are also ninjas. They just don't exist.
But this movie does get some details dead right. When Bourne is targeted by his own side, the film provides a masterclass in how to go on the run. Bob Baer is a CIA veteran of over 20 years, and he knows how hard it is to escape the clutches of a modern espionage agency.
You know, you can't use credit cards, you can't use phones, and you presumably have whatever government it is helping the United States look for you, so you've got to move fast.
The first thing our experts admire in Bourne is his people skills. As in this scene, where he persuades a stranger to give him a lift.
I'll give you $10,000 to drive me to Paris.
Ich denke eigentlich, ich bin total bescheuert, oder?
Ich denke nicht, dass du bescheuert bist.
He shows empathy towards her. He speaks German.
And I'll give you another 10 when we get there.
He throws her a wad of money.
You drive, I pay. It's that simple.
Scheiße. I got enough trouble, okay?
When she says, I can't do it, he says, give me the money back. He knows exactly how vulnerable she is.
Okay, can I have my money back?
So in essence, this little scene has some of the authentic aspects of a long-term recruitment.
But when they get to Paris, the woman has cause to regret taking the money, because Bourne is something of a magnet for trouble.
So...
what?
We got a bump coming up.
Bourne's never more than one step ahead of his pursuers. And former CIA operative Jason Matthews knows how this feels. He's been tailed more times than he cares to remember.
What is portrayed in the Bourne films is the sort of the desperation, the always looking over one's shoulder. We call what we do sort of the walking through the wilderness of mirrors. It's a very good portrayal of not knowing where the next threat is coming from.
But the Bourne scene our experts rated best of all is a virtuoso sequence set in London's Waterloo Station. Bourne is here to set up a meeting with a British journalist, but the journo's every move is being watched by the CIA, who will do anything to stop him from talking to Bourne.
Prepaid phone. The first interesting piece on this clip is the fact that Bourne is going to purchase a pay-and-go phone.
Ben Owen was a surveillance expert in the British Security Services.
Pay-and-go phones is an effective tool to stay under the radar.
Having slipped the phone into the journo's pocket, Bourne uses it to steer him away from trouble.
Hello?
Jimmy, I need that phone.
I want you to listen very carefully to what I'm about to tell you.
What the hell's going on?
10 o'clock.
To your left across the street, there's a silver Chrysler Voyager.
There's a surveillance team inside. Directly across the street, 12 noon, there's a man in the second story, static post. He's watching you.
Now, there's a bus stop 50 meters to your left. I want you to walk towards it.
Jimmy, I need that phone. I need it yesterday. He's on the move. He's on the move.
That's not his phone, sir.
Say again?
That's not his phone, sir.
What do you mean it's not his phone? Where the hell did he get another phone?
That's one of the things that this clip gets very right. Surveillance has profiles, and they're all of a type. They act differently. You can see them looking around, looking around, looking around.
The cameras Bourne's looking at. Again, he's keep Ross on a track here to stay out of camera sight. Wait.
Wait.
I'm gonna walk by you. I want you to
move along the far wall to your left in
4, 3, 2, 1, stand up. I would defy anyone to be able to do that in a London train station. There's cameras you can't see. You just can't walk anywhere in the station without being detected by a camera.
Where the hell is he? We cannot afford to lose this guy, people.
All right, that line you're on is good.
Stay on that line.
The journo is being drawn into a lethal game of cat and mouse.
Oh, the bin man. I think he's one of them.
The garbage man?
Negative.
Oh, Jesus. Jesus, he's reaching for something. Oh, God, he's got a gun. He's got a gun.
Stay on the line.
He's got a gun.
Do not deviate.
It's a very authentic aspect of what we do. We always see ghosts. When we're looking for surveillance, if you look at 10 people, two or three or four or five of them might be what we call ghosts, not actually surveillance, but it can make you alter your plans.
Do not deviate.
The journo has already shown he's not cut out for the spy game.
Okay, there he goes. Here he goes. Tell grab team.
Now the hunters have him in their sights, and he's about to make a fatal blunder.
The paranoia that kicks in when you do feel that you can't trust anyone. So any corner you turn, any car that drives past, that does eat away. You know, it won't be long before a mistake happens.
Just stay where you are. I don't think we should wait. I think someone's coming.
I'm going for it.
No.
For any security service to take a shot across a crowded Waterloo station and actually assassinate someone is totally Hollywood, totally dramatic. Someone would lose his career over that decision.
but we'll forgive this cinematic flourish in an otherwise brilliant portrayal of life on the run. It's almost time to reveal our secret agent's number one spy movie. But first, at number two in our countdown, a controversial film about the spies behind the biggest manhunt in history. The Oscar-nominated Zero Dark Thirty is a gripping account of the CIA's war on terror. Filmed in gritty documentary style, it stars Jessica Chastain as Maya, on the trail of the world's most notorious terrorist, Osama bin Laden.
I'll tell you what I really liked about Zero Dark Thirty. The main character was a woman analyst. And I thought, this is great! Now people are going to understand that there are women involved in this, and that made me happy.
Former CIA analyst Cynthia Storer is said to be one of the women Zero Dark's fictional Maya is based on.
I was the one who was the first one to jump up and say, this organization, this is how it's structured, and they call themselves Al-Qaeda.
Anyway, I thought you should know about it.
In this critical scene, Maya has to find a way through a maze of suspects to work out Al-Qaeda's leadership.
And she's looking at that big organizational chart and all the pictures. In the spy business, we call it eye candy. They like to see the pictures of people and whatever. In the early days, we had to, agency had to go out and buy one of these great big machines that prints huge pieces of paper so we could start seeing these network diagrams because they were getting so large. So then an analyst's job is to try to figure out how to unclutter it so that you can see the patterns that are underneath all of that.
But Maya's biggest challenge is to identify who in this rogues gallery will lead her to bin Laden. This takes her into the darkest side of espionage.
I own you, Amor. You belong to me. Look at me. If you don't look at me when I talk to you, I hurt you. If you step off this mat, I hurt you. If you lie to me, I'm gonna hurt you. Now, now, look at me. Look at me, Amor!
They're using a technique here, which is the pushing you off balance, the off-balance push, because you're trying to create confusion. You would do that in an environment to wear the subject down.
Former U.S. Naval Intelligence Officer Malcolm Nance used to train American servicemen how to withstand torture.
And then they strap him up, which is immediate stress and duress. That's a nice name for essentially beating tortures.
In a brilliant early twist, it's revealed that Maya is attending the interrogation sessions. She's determined to do whatever it takes to find bin Laden. But it's clear her good intentions are forcing her to make some difficult choices.
Come on, let's get a coffee.
No, we should go back in.
I remember one of our managers saying that there can never be another one, never be another attack. But that was the pressure, right? And so people were desperate to do anything that was going to prevent the next attack.
Come on, give it to me.
And soon, Maya finds herself helping out in the most extreme CIA interrogation technique, waterboarding.
I don't know! Where was the last time you saw bin Laden? Where was the last time you saw bin Laden, huh?
Waterboarding is controlled drowning.
In the 1990s, Malcolm Nance did research on waterboarding because it was a torture technique his compatriots might have to endure. But after 9/11, this work was turned upside down and became a how-to guide for CIA interrogators.
Well, I felt an amazing shock that somebody would take a program like this, you know, and flip it on its head and use it again. What we actually teach in these programs were war crimes. Our moral compass was turned on its head to where we decided we would choose the techniques of totalitarian regimes and our former enemies. And that is just disgraceful.
Zero Dark builds to an action-packed climax in a nighttime raid into Pakistan, conducted on the intelligence gathered by Maya.
Down.
All right, get it.
And this is the crucial moment when Maya discovers she's got her man.
For God and country, Geronimo.
Bin Laden was killed on May 2nd, 2011, almost 10 years after 9/11.
And on nights like this one, we can say to those families who have lost loved ones to Al-Qaeda's terror, justice has been done.
President Obama announced the death of Bin Laden as a triumph for America. But Maya has paid a heavy personal price.
These are kind of moral conundrums that you're faced with if you're going to work in a spy agency. Now, when you're in a situation like after 9/11 and you know the stakes are really high, I think you do have a tendency to tolerate more than you would under other conditions. It's just human nature.
Coming up, it's the spy movie that our real spooks rate as the best ever. And we learn about the real spy at the heart of it.
From the time I was quite small, in my father's dressing room on the side, there was always his money and a knuckle duster.
We've been counting down the world's greatest spy movies, from the action-packed to the most ingenious. Finally, it's time to reveal the film that our spies picked above all others as the most true-to-life depiction of the spying game. It's a story of double agents and the most famous mole hunt in spy movie history. Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy is based on a novel set in the 1970s during the Cold War. And the main character is the most unlikely spy movie hero of all, a middle-aged man in a raincoat with an ironic name. He's George Smiley, played here by Gary Oldman in an Oscar-nominated performance.
We both spend our lives looking for the weaknesses in one another's systems. Don't you think it's time to recognize there is as little worth on your side as there is on mine?
The theme of Tinker Tailor is treachery. And it begins with an MI6 agent, played here by Mark Strong. He's on a secret mission behind the Iron Curtain, but he's beginning to suspect that his cover has been blown. He's been betrayed by a double agent inside British intelligence, a mole. Enter George Smiley. It's his job to catch the traitor. But in Smiley's world, there are no fast cars or gadgets. This is a tense game of mental chess. But Smiley's thoughtful approach is one that strikes a chord with real agents.
The way that he goes about his business, it couldn't be more different than a James Bond approach. He's quiet, he's studious, very observant. And that resonates with me.
But what also impressed our experts is the tortured complexity of Smiley the Man.
George Smiley has become one of the great figures of modern fiction, both on screen and in the books. And it's the combination that he's brilliant. He's a man of absolute integrity, but at the same time, he's a man of huge vulnerability. The peculiar thing about him, in the end, he's a loser. You know, his wife has constantly betrayed him. He's terribly lonely. He finds friendship very difficult. One thing you know for sure about Smiley is that his story will not have a happy ending.
The creator of Tinker Tailor is Britain's greatest spy novelist, John le Carré. Le Carré, real name David Cornwell, based Tinker Tailor on his own experience of having been a spy during the 1960s.
They're joined by a lot of things, the spies, very often by their own insufficiency as human beings. People who take refuge in the clandestine world tend to be unanchored or very shy. They want to work in private. They share some sense of specialness so that when they go out and catch a tube, they can say to themselves as they go down the escalator, well, I know a few things you don't.
Le Carré drew his inspiration for Tinker Tailor from a real-life spy scandal of the 1960s when a senior MI6 officer, Kim Philby, was exposed as a double agent.
The Secret Service, as it was depicted in David Cornwell's John le Carré's novels, was the Secret Service of the 60s and 70s, which was the depth of the Cold War. And it was also the time when paranoia was greatest within both MI5 and MI6 about traitors in their own ranks, that everybody working there was looking over their shoulders, asking, well, who's working for the Russians?
The central character of Tinker Tailor, George Smiley, was based, in part at least, on a real spy, one of John le Carré's colleagues from his days in MI6, John Bingham.
From the time I was quite small, in my father's dressing room on the side, there was always his money and a knuckle duster. And I used to try it on, and it used to, you know, fall off, and I used to pretend to do that to him and that sort of thing. And he used to say, they're jolly useful, you know.
Like John Bingham, George Smiley is softly spoken, but with a streak of ruthlessness, a quality that was vividly brought to life by Sir Alec Guinness in the first on-screen adaptation of Tinker Tailor, back in 1979.
And was that the end of it?
More or less, yes.
I have to know everything, Jim.
The rest was just gossip. You wanted to know a lot of circus tittle-tattle, who was going up, who was going down, a lot of tripe.
About what? Who?
It's Alec Guinness. He's almost interchangeable with my father in some scenes. Really is. I recognize my father's intransigence.
I want to put a thesis to you, Toby, about what's been going on.
My father was able to have a very cold manner when interviewing, or interrogating, really. And believe you me, if he turned it on you as when you were late back from a party or something, you wouldn't want to be there. I used to say icicles came from the ceiling.
Hoisted on the burning deck. One saw that he had fled.
As the movie of Tinker Tailor reaches its dramatic climax, Gary Oldman's Smiley lays an ingenious trap to catch the mole. Smiley's strategy is to flush him out with a fake telegram to London HQ, suggesting that the traitor is about to be exposed. When the mole hurries to meet his Russian handler, Smiley is quietly waiting, armed and ready. And the trap closes. By today's standards, Tinker Tailor is distinctly low-tech. But even at a time when espionage seems to be all about satellites and surveillance, the film still has relevance for real spies.
Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy really shines a spotlight on the human component of espionage. There is a perception increasingly that spying is all about satellite imagery, it's about telephone, email intercept. So people with real secrets are tending now to keep them in their heads. And that's where spies like me come in. We have to access those individuals and what they're keeping locked inside their heads, which means that Tinker Tailor is as relevant today as it's always been.
One of the things that makes the world of espionage so weird is the fact that nobody is ever quite sure whose side anybody is on. And this is the mood that comes across so well in the Tinker Tailor film and the television series which preceded it. Yes, we need our spies. Yes, we should respect them. but we should never totally trust them because they certainly don't trust themselves or each other.
A divided Germany at the height of the Cold War, and a young soldier is sent undercover in the West. Powerful new drama Deutschland 83 starts tomorrow at 9. Next, though, trust no one in the film adaptation of the John le Carré classic, Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy.